Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. If you checked out my video from last week, we ended up installing my MaxJax in my garage finally after having it for 6 months just sitting here. So today what I'm going to show you how to do is actually wire up 240 volts for the power unit, and then we're going to be running some lines over the ceiling and onto the other column. That way I don't have lines all over my floors and it's a nice clean install. So stay tuned. So the MaxJax power unit is rated for 120 volts because the contactor inside is for 120, and it comes with a 120 whip and it plugs into a 120 outlet. The reason why you want to go 240 is it provides a little bit more power or amperage for the motor, and the motor runs a little bit faster versus the 120. In order to convert it to 220 or 240, you actually have to change the contactor inside this box right here. We'll have a wiring diagram on the screen right now to kind of show you guys the gist of the wiring to convert from 120 to 240 volt. For the MaxJax power unit, it's actually a BendPak Ranger power unit. And if you look on the nameplate, the motor says 115 or 120 volt. But the reason why they put that is because of the contactor inside here. This motor is actually a multi-tap that's good for 120 or 240 volt single phase. So obviously, if you're gonna convert to 240, you need a 240 outlet or 240 nearby your power unit. I've actually just ran my 240 volt right here back to my sub panel, so I have a dedicated 20 amp 240 volt right here. For this outlet, I'm using a NEMA L620R, which is a 20 amp receptacle, and we're gonna install the mating plug with that onto this cable right here, so that way we just plug this into here. We're just gonna end up cutting the 120 end off of here and just wiring it to that new plug. So here's the NEMA L620 plug right here that we're gonna be replacing. This baby is kind of a big boy, but it plugs right in and it twist locks. And we're gonna have to replace the contactor that's in there and rewire it. So here's the contactor we're gonna be using. Once I get everything assembled, I need to assemble my new chair slash creeper slash stool that is going to help me work under the car easier. In addition, I got to unpack these jack stands I bought. I bought a set of 10-ton jack stands just in case I do something under the car and I don't really trust the lift just yet. So every time I'm working under the car, I'm going to make sure I have these jack stands onto at least the lift arms or the actual chassis of the car just in case something happens. Over here to get to the contactor, we want to take off this cover right here, just two screws on the side here. So once you get inside, you'll have the switch right here. You'll have a wiring diagram on the back that kind of shows you how to wire up the motor. And you have your contactor inside here. You want to just pull this whole thing out. So to remove this unit, you just basically just pull it and slide it right out. There's little rails down here that it slides into. And then what you're gonna see is on this side right here, which is called the L side or the line side, what you'll have is you'll have the two black and whites coming in, which is the power, and then you'll have the switch. One side of the switch goes to one of the slots on here, and then the other side goes to the second slot and it jumps through. Every time you push the switch, you're just activating the electromagnet that pulls this contactor down and it makes the contactor cross the terminals. The one thing you'll notice on the 120 version is, so your blue and your red is actually just piggybacking off the black and the white. So what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be following this direction right here for the 220 version of this. So if you study the diagram on the back of here, you'll see the 230 volt and the 115 volt wiring. The dashed lines are 115, the solid lines are 230. On the 230, we jumper the red and the blue together and we don't even connect that to anything. If you see on the 115, you'll see the blue and the red terminated on the T2 and T3 on the contactor. So that's what it's doing right now. If you compare the two contactors, they're essentially the same size contactor, except this one's rated for 120. This is rated for up to 240. And it's got a couple extra holes for contacts that we're not using for our situation. So if you guys look at the diagram I'm showing on the screen right now, we're gonna just mimic what we have here now. The only difference is the red and the blue are gonna just be terminated on T1. We're not using T1 as a crossover, so we'll just use that as a jumper. You don't even need to do that. You can actually jumper these two separately without putting it onto the contactor, but since we don't have any place to put these wires, we might as well just put it here for safety. To keep things simple, I'll just do one wire at a time and we'll just swap it over so we don't mix anything up. So now we'll do the motor side. So the easiest way to do the motor side will be just to just take everything apart. You know you have the jumper red and blue together. White and black, you just match opposite of the ones you already connected. So a little quick lesson on how a contactor works. A contactor is essentially a relay, right, that lets you transfer power across the terminals. You don't want to pull all the amps through this little switch, so we use that switch to activate the relay or the contactor. What happens is whenever the contactor makes the connection, the electromagnet pulls this little blue part, which is the bus, actually goes down. Terminals across here make a connection. So what we do is to test that, so I stick my continuity meter here, we don't hear any beep or any noise, right? But if I push this thing down, you'll hear the beeping. So that's my multimeter beeping because the contact is going through and we're making a continuity. So now we're just gonna jump these two wires right here together. You can actually use T1 or normally open 14 over here because, like I said, the contactor basically just makes, once this button is pushed down or the electromagnet pulls it down, it just makes the contact between these two sides right here opposite of each other. So if you don't use the one on the other side, it doesn't really matter. You won't be shorting anything out. So we'll go ahead and just use the one that's closest to the inside right now, which is normally open. So there, once we have that, we'll just go ahead and tuck the wires in. Make sure there's nothing pinched or anything, and then just slide it in. So the bottom rail here snaps right in, or slides right in. You could also snap it. There's this little spring-loaded clip right here, so you could tuck it in one side and just snap it on this side too. To wire the plug, you want to just take apart the plug that you bought, which is a twist lock plug. It comes with three holes. You just unscrew that. This side over here, you just want to string your cord right through there and then tighten it down. The strain relief bolts are right here. So what the first thing we need to do is just cut the plug off of this guy. So we'll go ahead and just cut this guy. I kind of really want to cut it as close as I can, but then you never know if I ever need to relocate this and need some wire. So I just cut maybe like 2 feet off of it and then just coil the rest behind the unit. First thing you want to do is kind of strip this insulation back. I'll just use a razor blade. Just be careful not to cut the actual wires inside. So now that we've got this thing stripped back, make sure we didn't damage any of the insulation on the inside wires. We want to just slide this thing through here. Once we get it onto there, we want to strip these wires back. This is a 14-3 cable, so you just want to make sure you select the 14 and just trim back enough. So we want to do the ground first. That's the green, the obvious one. And since this is 220 volt or 240 volt, it probably doesn't matter which of the two that you terminate because they're going to both be just one leg of 120. It's not like a hot end neutral on 120. All right, so there we have it right there. Everything's nice and tight. Strain relief is tightened down. Everything's tight here. Wiring's good. Put the rear cap back on and we're good to plug this up and test it now. All right, so I plugged it in, hit the breaker for the 220 volt or 240 volt, and we're gonna test it to see if it runs. Yep, runs. The motor sounds a lot faster now versus the 120 though. If you watched my install video last week, you'll notice I put in this 90 degree L bracket right here for the fitting that comes out of the power unit. And the reason why I did that so I could have the cable go straight up to the ceiling here, and then I'm gonna puncture a hole in the ceiling and then go across above the drywall and then down on that side right there. So we'll go ahead and show you what we're gonna be using to do that. So for the overhead holes that we're gonna use, we're gonna end up just cutting gang holes into the ceiling. So I got a double gang for the side I'm going to enter in, and then the side that I'm going to exit on the other side, I've got a single gang. And these are just regular data port, old work gang box things. And the reason why we want to use this is because it actually protects the drywall when we pull the hose through. It actually provides the holes to put the cover plates on. So what I did was I took a regular single gang cover plate, drilled a hole in it. I'm going to end up slitting or cutting one side here so I could tuck it around the hose and then have it up there. And to cut the holes for the gang boxes, I'm going to use my gang box cutter right here. This thing works wonders and it makes cutting the holes a breeze. It takes like literally 10 seconds to cut a hole. Once the holes are cut, I'm going to fish this across so I can actually have something to pull the hose through. That way I'm not hunting for the hole on the other end.
So I went ahead and measured everything, made sure I didn't hit any studs right here, and put in my rough dimensions so I could use that drywall cutter just to cut the exact hole. So that drywall cutter wasn't that easy to cut up there for some reason. It got the line good enough for me to use the saw. So I'm gonna go ahead and just finish that off now. I got into there, made sure there was nothing blocking it as far as a beam or anything above it, which is good. We have a nice hollow opening, so we'll just go ahead and finish the rest of it by hand. We're able to get that cut over there, and it's a straight shot across, so that's gonna be pretty easy for the cable right now to just fish it over. That was pretty easy. Got that thing fished right over, down and around, and I left most of the slack up above there. I'm gonna go ahead and fasten everything down with these straps over here and then on the lift itself over there, and then we'll go ahead and finish this part of the install.
In my veins, I've been driving this train. Years in this lane, there's no stopping this flame. Cause I came to the game and I changed it to play. How I like, rearranged it to my own domain. Yeah, I got what it takes, made lots of mistakes. Taking shots, skipping breaks, feeling lost, feeling great, popping.
All right, we were able to get everything connected. I used those straps right there to connect it all to the walls. We got it over the ceiling and then back down over to this side. And down to the towers. On the back side of this tower, I ended up using some existing points to put my straps. And up here, I ended up using this hole right here, which just has a rubber stopper right here. I'm not sure what it's for. It must be for some accessory or something that's not used. So I just took that out. I put a 10 millimeter bolt and nut. Since I'm using 3/4 inch EMT straps, so I used some vacuum hose cut in half to put in here as a wedge to keep it solid and without slipping out.
So I'm gonna be unboxing my Sonex 410 set of 10 ton jack stands right now. I bought these back when I got this lift 6 months ago. I haven't touched it since. Still in the box, all the straps are on it, but we'll go ahead and just take this out and see how tall these
coming
are.
Coming up on the horizon, I lose track of time. Yeah, I move fast and climb, a new class divine. Yeah, true passion shines and I'm through passing time. I choose stacking dimes, you snooze half the time while I move passing by. I work hard each and every day.
So I got the jack stands all set up. These are like 10 ton jack stands designed for like semi trucks and really big trucks. And for what we're using it for is overkill, but what I needed it for was the height. So I can use this the way I had it set up right now, where it's just holding the lift arms when they're up. That way the weight of the car ends up transferring to these two jack stands and we take it off the two towers on the side. We could use it this way, or we could actually put these on the frame of the car depending on what we're doing, or we could put it on the front or the back of the car to keep it from teetering back and forth, just to add a little bit of extra safety depending on what we're doing in the car, like if we're removing the transmission or doing something where we may tilt the car. We don't want it tipping either way if it's off balance. So either way, these jack stands add another layer of safety when working under the car when we're using this lift. Hey guys, thanks for tuning all the way to the end of this video on upgrading the voltage on my MaxJax power unit. I know most of you guys that have MaxJax probably are gonna stick with 120 volts, but for the few that wanna upgrade to the 240 volts, I hope you found this video useful. In addition, if you own a MaxJax and getting those other accessories that I got, those are probably gonna be useful for you, especially the jack stands for safety and then the creeper if you don't already have the OEM BendPak creeper that they sell. For all these different projects in the garage, on the car, or on the house, remember guys, if I can do it, you guys can do it. Also, if you haven't subscribed to your channel yet to stay on top of all my different projects and my DIYs, go ahead and subscribe to your channel, like this video if you found it useful, and I'll talk to you guys next time.